who will introduce Naomi Klein. Michelle is an environmental justice and community activist based in South Detroit. She is an advocate for participatory democracy, collective resource management, and popular education. She has worked with organizations such as the Michigan Whole Communities, the Environmental Justice Coalition, the Sierra Club, and others. As I noted, she is an alum of the University of Michigan, having completed her BS here in the departments of English and Anthropology, as well as earning a master's in environmental policy. Michelle, will you come up? And can I ask everybody to make sure that their cell phones are turned off?
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
That's right. We're all so excited to hear from Naomi Klein, and thank you so much to the Institute for Humanities for opening the doors for great lectures like this, Naomi Klein and others throughout the semester. Really excited to be here. If you had told me as an undergraduate that I would be up here introducing Naomi Klein in 2003, I would not have believed it. I was reading No Logo and staying up late sewing in my living room worried about maquiladoras, and went to maquiladoras and saw the horrifying truth of what that meant, and it totally transformed my life. So thank you for the opportunity today to do this. It's an honor and a privilege. I want to take the opportunity today to talk to the young people in the room. I feel like it's an important opportunity as somebody thinking back to 2003 when I was on campus, and think about our role as a generation, because we've known no other reality than the Reagan era austerity. We've known no other reality than this climate regime, and we've known no other reality than globalization. And as a generation, as Naomi highlights in her book, we have a sense of solastalgia, homesickness when you are at home. So whether you believe this to be true today, I think it's only faith that's going to save us. And as Erica Badu, hip-hop poet, has stated, most intellects do not believe in God, but the fear is just the same. So where can we draw certainty and hope from an era of uncertain truth, instability, and crisis? I'd like to present an idea for our generation that has to do with its linguistic roots in Latin. And as someone who learned Spanish later in life, I found a fascinating difference between two words, hogar and lugar. I find the difference is foundational in the way that we can manifest movement spaces to put an end to hegemonic climate regimes like the one that we have today. Much like space and place, lugar and hogar refer to a kind of physical space and a metaphysical space. They overlap. Both words, lugar and hogar, they come from Latin, and the base word, both come from the word foco, the root word of focus, the center, the light, the family, the home. When they separate, lugar literally means place. What is your place? The word itself is bounded in geography. You can pull out your iPhone and type in an address and it'll pull up on Google Earth. So it's literal. It will decay in the elements. It's geometric and linear. But these lugares, they're disappearing because they're rooted in consumption. They can be commodified and privatized, bound by the limits in law, and as such, can be embedded in the type of hetero-patriarchal societies created by the legacies of colonialism and capitalism. Hogar, on the other hand, this is a place that brings energy to life. Where is your spot? Where is your space? What makes you live? What fuels your hearth? Where do you keep it? Whose bowl does your hearth feed? I ask you, how do you tend to your hogar? And why do you hide it? This Ogaida is infinite. It cannot be co-opted and it cannot be corrupted. It cannot be tracked, and it's not on Google Earth. This Ogaida is an inspiration to get out of bed every day and stand to say, this is enough. Your Ogaida is this place unseen, but felt. Climate change is here, and we will lose land. We'll watch it burn as we do in Indonesia. We'll see entire communities flooded and flee from famine. There will be fewer lugares for us to lay our heads, but even more hogares for us to continue to grow our movements. So this is a call to grow your hogar, to find a space in the society in which status quo cannot exist. Like the Black Lives Matter movements and like Idle No More, we need more movements to stand up and say no. In Detroit, we have folks like Detroiters Resisting Emergency Managers standing up for democracy. That's right, I see a wave in the air. Hell yeah. That's right. The People's Water Board Coalition saying, water is a human right and people deserve to have it in their homes. That's right. Detroit Eviction Defense Coalition saying, this is someone's land. This is someone's house. This is where we grew our children. We deserve to be here, not to let banks profit from our misery. So this is the call to demand the dignity of human rights in this hogar. And Naomi Klein, the woman for whom we're here today, her hogar has burned so bright, it's inspired millions and millions of people all over the globe. Her words and ideas are an inspiration to stop allowing business as usual, to operate in an economic system that's destroying life on Earth today. Her books have been read in 30 different languages all over the world. She's an award-winning journalist, a syndicated columnist, and authors of bestsellers like This Changes Everything. I want to raise up this book because this changes everything. This changes everything. Give her a round of applause as she's coming in. She's an award winner of the Hillary Western Writers Trust Prize, and now her movie coming out this fall. We're gonna get to see a clip right now and hear from Naomi Klein.
See global warming as a serious threat. Celebrate! Climate legislation is dead.
We, in the global north, with less than 20% of the population, are responsible for over 70% of global emissions.
We are growing all over the place.
On the other side of the world, those people who are the most affected by climate change, most affected by environmental injustice, have the least responsibility for creating this crisis in the first place.
In the lima baku, sir, in nil, sir, in nil na kaku burst.
The amount of fossil fuel that we're combusting year on year is growing. We're going in completely the wrong direction.
I spent 6 years wandering through the wreckage caused by the carbon in the air and the economic system that put it there.
That old paradigm will be forced into change, either by the environment around us or by us.
I see communities who are thrown into the front line. Incredible transformation. They become stronger, they stand up.
So here's the big question.
celebrate the limits, because we could reinvent a different future.
Martinez, that was just about the most beautiful, poetic, and wise introduction I think I've ever heard. Thank you. So, thank you for that, and thank you for everything you are doing to defend your home place and our collective home in the process. So I'm told that one of the themes of this series is conversion. Conversion of the climate, conversion of the economy. And that is really at the heart of the work that I'm doing on climate change. This question of whether or not we collectively are capable of change. And the reason why I called the book This Changes Everything is not because the book changes everything. I'm not so arrogant as to claim that. It's because climate change changes everything. And I wanted to find a title for the book that would begin the discussion about climate change, where I think this discussion has to begin when we talk about this now. 2.5 decades since scientists told us that they now weren't sure, as James Hansen did in 1988 in front of Congress, that he now had a high degree of certainty that human activity was causing climate change and that we needed to act. And it was that year that the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was formed. Since our governments started needing to talk about lowering emissions, global emissions have gone up by more than 60%. So when we talk about climate change now, we face what the climate scientist Michael Mann calls the procrastination penalty. So the procrastination penalty means, essentially, that there are now no non-radical options left on the table. If we stay on the road we're on, if we basically do nothing, that road leads us to 4 to 6 degrees Celsius of warming. Those numbers don't come from 350.org, they don't come from Greenpeace, they come from the World Bank, and they come from PricewaterhouseCoopers. That's who says we're headed towards 4 to 6 degrees warming, if we continue with what they call business as usual. So in order to get to that very radical place, this place where entire countries disappear, coastal cities disappear, mass agricultural failure, all we have to do is nothing. Just keep doing what we're doing now. So it doesn't feel very radical. It doesn't feel radical, but the result is radical. Now, it is not too late to prevent that radical future. But because we have waited so long, we now need to do so much to lower emissions very, very quickly that it requires changing pretty much everything about our political and economic system, because our political and economic system is not built to allow us to cut emissions as deeply as we need to cut them. In the book, I rely on figures from the Tyndall Center on Climate Change Research, which is one of the leading climate research institutions in the world in Manchester, England. And what they say is that in countries like the United States and Canada, where I live, we need to be cutting our emissions by 8 to 10% a year. Now, all kinds of measures have been announced. We know that Obama has introduced some pretty aggressive measures on coal burning, and it's better than what there was before, but it is not in any way leading to the kind of emission reduction that we need to have. But the argument I make in the book is that if we want to understand why we have failed so miserably to meet this challenge, A lot of it has to do with a case of epic bad timing. I mentioned 1988, the year that James Hansen testified before Congress. Now, I don't think there could have been a worse time for human beings to get this news, that we have to get ourselves off fossil fuels. And the reason is that 1988 was the high point for this ideological project that in most parts of the world is called neoliberalism. It used to be called the Washington Consensus. Sometimes it's just called globalization. 1988 is the year before the Berlin Wall collapsed. It is the year that Canada and the US signed the first free trade agreement that became the prototype for NAFTA, and then the prototype for all the deals that we're seeing now, like the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And the pillars of this ideological project that led Francis Fukuyama that year to declare history over, that there was just one single economic model. That project, the pillars of that project are privatization, deregulation, cuts to corporate taxes, paid for with cuts to public spending, all locked in under corporate free trade deals. Now, this is just the air we breathe. This is all, as Michelle said, all most young people in this audience, or pretty much everybody under 40 in this audience, all we've ever known, right? This is the system that we just call the economy, but it was not always thus. And the problem we have is that these pillars of privatization, deregulation, this aversion to taxing the wealthy and corporations, it has put us on a collision course with climate change. Because underpinning all of this is the idea that there is something wrong with collective action. As Margaret Thatcher said, there is no such thing as society, only families and individuals. When Charles Koch announced that his organization was going to be marshaling almost $1 billion in the next presidential cycle of spending, $1 billion, $900 million, he said that this money was going to be spent to hold back what he called the march of collectivism, That is the uniting idea behind everything that the Koch brothers fund, whether it is a tax on Social Security or labor rights or climate change. This is their unifying theory that collective is bad, individual is good. This is a problem when dealing with a crisis like climate change because it is the essence of a collective crisis. It is not something we can do as individuals. We tried that, right? We all changed our light bulbs and recycled. Didn't work, did it? Because actually this takes laws. This takes telling corporations that they actually can't do whatever they want. And it requires taxing them. It requires saying no to them. And these all were dismissed as so-called command and control approaches in the era that we've been dealing with climate change. So we could only talk about market-friendly measures, carbon trading, and so on. And those are in countries that did anything at all, like in Europe. Now, the argument I make in This Changes Everything is that this is not all bad news. There's a couple of ways that you could see this. You know, some of my friends in the environmental movement have sort of said to me, you know, Naomi, climate change was big enough, did you have to make it about capitalism, right? I can see where they're coming from, but the argument that I make is that it is not as if we are dealing with an economic system that is going really, really well, except for the small matter of rising sea levels. It is actually an economic system that is failing the vast majority of people on this planet. Ask people in Detroit having their water cut off, or people in Greece who keep trying to vote in governments that will take on austerity and they keep ending up with it. This system is failing a great many people, but what climate change does is it puts us on a firm and unyielding science-based deadline, and it says it's not enough to oppose these policies. We actually need to change the system, and we have to do it fast. The right understands this. You know, if you look at the statistics on who denies climate change, you know, most people in the United States don't deny climate change. But if you look at the far right of the political spectrum, and you ask people about their worldview, those with an extremely hierarchical worldview
overwhelmingly deny climate change. People who don't believe in a positive role for government at all, believe that poor people generally get what they deserve, overwhelmingly deny climate change. And you know, there have been all kinds of research done on this at Yale University looking at the correlation between worldview and belief in climate change. And the reason for that is that if you have this worldview that sees no role for the collective, that sees any intervention in the market as a crime against humanity, then you are going to have a big problem with climate change, because the right understands that you can't deal with this crisis without market intervention. And you know, I spent a fair bit of time hanging out at the Heartland Institute, this sort of hotbed of climate change denial, and they're very open about it, that they don't come to this from the scientific perspective. This is a free market think tank. And they only got interested in climate change when they realized that if the science was true, then it would mean that their whole ideological project falls apart. So they chose to, as Joseph Bass told me, the head of the Heartland Institute, we decided to take a second look at the science, right? So, you know, I said I think this can be good news because the system is failing us on so many other fronts. We know we have to get corporations out of politics for basically any reason you can name, whether it's healthcare, gun control, or climate change. But this puts us on a deadline. And we have a chance to build a more humane, fair, more equitable system as we transition off fossil fuels. Now, I have been called an optimist, which I struggle with, I have to tell you. You know, because I don't come to this issue out of sort of just thinking about the sunny side of disasters. Those of you who know my last book, The Shock Doctrine, know that, you know, I come to this really by looking very closely at the worst that humans are capable of in the midst of crisis. The Shock Doctrine begins and ends with Hurricane Katrina, and this process that led me to write this book very much began 10 years ago, a little more than 10 years ago, when, like all of you, I assume, I turned on my television and saw people on their rooftops in New Orleans holding signs that said help, and watched helicopters pass them by. People abandoned in hospitals, like Memorial and Charity in New Orleans. And, you know, I guess unlike most people, because I'm weird, I went to New Orleans while it was still flooded. I was working on the Shock Doctrine and researched that firsthand, researched what was going on in New Orleans. And that's where I saw so vividly this collision between this ideological project that has been ascendant in the decades that we've been dealing with climate change, and what we have to do in the face of the crisis. Because if we think about Katrina, what happened there, the disaster was not just the result of a hurricane. Katrina was a huge storm, but by the time it hit New Orleans, it had been downgraded to a tropical storm. It was no longer a Category 5 hurricane. It should never have broken the levees. It broke the levees because the levees had been neglected, like so much of our public infrastructure, like so much of the public sphere. And then the next stage of disaster happened because all levels of government were entirely dysfunctional. People here in Michigan don't know anything about that, I'm sure. You know, I mean, if you remember the shock that FEMA, the department in charge of disaster response, couldn't seem to find New Orleans for 5 days, and people were abandoned in the Superdome, in the convention center, without food, without water. But worse than that, because it wasn't just the collision of heavy weather and weak and neglected, willfully neglected public infrastructure and government that couldn't organize an evacuation. Layered on top of that was the legacy and current reality of racism and white supremacy. So then those victims were further victimized in the media, on Fox, called animals. There were all of these unfounded rumors about how babies were being raped in the Superdome. All of them turned out to be lies. Then there were all the signs, members, looters will be shot on site. Looters, just people looking for food, for diapers, for their kids. And then people were called refugees in their own country. They were rescued
at gunpoint in public housing, given one-way tickets out of their city. And it became this social engineering project. First came the shock, then came what I call the shock doctrine. Because when New Orleans was emptied of all of those inconvenient people, with all of their inconvenient ideas about how their schools should be rebuilt, how their public housing should be rebuilt, it was treated as a blank slate. Now, there was one quote, and this was said while I was in New Orleans, the city was still underwater, and Richard Baker, who's then a Republican congressman from Louisiana, he said, we finally cleaned up public housing in New Orleans. We couldn't do it, but God did it. Remember that? And that's what happened, you know. Many housing projects in New Orleans that were not even flooded were demolished, replaced with condominiums and townhouses, and the school system in New Orleans came under the same sort of attack. Thousands of teachers were fired, the school board was taken over under cover of emergency, and New Orleans now has the most privatized school system in the United States. Before the storm, there were 8 charter schools in New Orleans. Now, nearly 95% of the city's public school students attend a charter school. Charity Hospital, which was it's a public hospital, a teaching hospital. It was one of the only places where poor African Americans could get health care in the city. It is still locked. It's still padlocked. It should have been reopened. It wasn't reopened. It was one more example of taking advantage of a crisis that was born out of a collision between heavy weather and a weak and neglected public sphere to just finish off the public sphere altogether, whether it's the schools, public housing, or public hospitals. So this textbook example of what I wrote about in the shock doctrine, exploiting and intensifying that atmosphere of emergency to push pro-corporate policies and to do what a lot of people would have liked to do otherwise, even without any kind of crisis. You know, I mentioned that New Orleans has the most privatized school system, the highest use of charter schools. After that comes Detroit. Flint and Grand Rapids are both in the top 10. And I always remember after Katrina when there were these images of, you know, the lower Ninth Ward areas that were just hammered by Katrina. I remember, I think it was Michael Moore saying, that's what Flint looks like now, you know, without a disaster. You know, the disaster is capitalism. Forget disaster capitalism. So it's gotten a lot worse since the financial crisis in 2008 with the debt offloaded onto municipalities. And we've seen these attacks on the public school system, on public lands, parks taken over, turned into golf courses in Benton Harbor. Mm-hmm. And then there is this moral travesty of the water cutoffs in Detroit and elsewhere. And many believe, as you know, that these cutoffs are the first stage of water privatization, that this balancing of the books is to get the public utilities ready for privatization, because nobody's going to want to buy a utility if it can't be profitable. And I've been reading in the last few days about what, you know, reminding myself of what's been happening here, I was just struck so much by how many different fronts, particularly African-American young people in the state, how many different fronts they are under attack, you know? Mm-hmm. That their schools are being shut down and privatized, some are losing their parks, their lungs are under attack because so many of those schools are scandalously close to coal-fired power plants and some of the most polluted neighborhoods in this country. And then some of these same homes are losing their water, which are creating a host of other health crises. And then you know, you look at the water prices in Flint, which is just, you know, unbelievable. And you know, obviously this is, that thankfully what happened, the lead in the water in Flint, there has been action on that, and it's thankfully been reversed just recently as a result of really heroic community organizing. And this region is just so blessed to have some of the most inspiring grassroots, incredibly you know, place-based organizing anywhere in this country that is just animated by this very, very deep love of place, a vision of the future that could be so much better. And I'm thinking of groups like the Coalition for Clean Water, the Detroit Water Brigade, the Detroit People's Water Board, the Michigan Welfare Rights Organization. I mean, don't take this for granted, because this is really unique, and it's why so many people from across the country come to Detroit to study this kind of community organizing. And it would be a lot worse if it weren't for this kind of grassroots response and neighbors coming together and giving each other water and this this solidarity that is so moving. Now, all of this is intimately linked to climate change, because as water becomes more scarce, if we treat water as a commodity like any other, rather than a human right, as Michelle said, then we're going to see more and more of this kind of profiteering. And the other thing we've seen under emergency managers is the outsourcing of things like firefighting, treating that as another profit-making opportunities. And these are the workers who are on the front lines of climate change. Another example of climate injustice, what our response to climate change looks like if we don't change the system, if we don't actually confront this need for system change, we can see right now in California, which is in the fourth year of a devastating drought, as you all know. It's impacting the agricultural system in this entire country. And the fire, you know, fire season should be over in California by now. It's not. These are some of the highest risk jobs. What a lot of people don't know is that a great many of the people fighting fires in California are actually prison inmates. Yep. 4,000 of the 10,000 state firefighters in California working for Cal Fire are prison inmates. They get paid $2 a day. If they're actively fighting fires, they get paid $1 an hour. California does this because it saves them an estimated $1 billion a year. Now, California has criminally overcrowded prisons. The courts have ordered them to release prisoners because of criminal overcrowding. And there have actually been arguments made by the state in court that they cannot release prisoners because it would put their firefighting at risk. So this is what climate injustice looks like, and this is why we need climate justice. When I presented this book for the first time in Oakland, California a few months ago, I spoke with an organizer with a group called Movement Generation, and a guy named Quentin Sekofa, who is part of the food justice movement in the Bay Area. And he said this thing that has really stayed with me. He said, transition is inevitable, justice is not. Justice is not. So what we are seeing, you know, with the water cutoffs, with the prison inmates fighting fires, with what we saw in New Orleans, is what climate injustice looks like, what the transition to a climate change world looks like if we don't put justice front and center. We don't need to go to the Cineplex to imagine it. We can see it in our own cities. The good news is that climate change, I think, has given us some of the strongest arguments we will ever have to fight for this kind of system change, to fight for responses to climate change that solve multiple problems at once. And we even have some large-scale examples of what this would look like. One of the most dramatic energy transitions, probably the most dramatic energy transitions taking place anywhere in the world, is in Germany. That collision between a weak and neglected public sphere is not just about responding to the disasters. It's also that we need to invest in the public sphere in order to get off fossil fuel.
right? So it's not just about dealing with the disasters, but we have to deal with those disasters with a strong public sector, whether it's firefighters or whether it's taking care of our levees. But we also need to invest in public transit, in a transformed energy grid, all of that, energy efficiency. Now in Germany, where neoliberalism, for historical reasons, has never been fully embraced, Germany brutally prescribes austerity on other countries, like Greece and Spain. But because of the Second World War and an awareness of what happens in Germany when things get bad economically, Germany, thank goodness, has never fully embraced this at home. They maintain a pretty sturdy social safety net in Germany for these historical reasons. And there is this willingness to take bold action. And after the Fukushima disaster, the very strong green movement in Germany, it's a very anti-nuclear movement in Germany, successfully pushed to accelerate the energy transition. So in a decade and a half, Germany went from getting almost none of its electricity from renewables to now getting 30% of its electricity from renewables. And the really exciting part, is that this is Germany. I mean, what's scandalous about this is parts of the United States, like Florida, Arizona, you know, are way behind that. This is Germany, you know, dark, rainy, not very sunny place. They're getting 30% in winter. In summer, they get more than 50% of their electricity. From renewables. And much of it is decentralized, community-owned, and controlled. So the slogan in Germany is not just for energy transition, but for energy democracy. So in big cities and small towns, people have decided to reverse the privatization of their energy grids that happened in the 1990s and to take back local control over their energy grids and move to 100% renewable, because the private companies that took over their energy grids were not willing to do that transition fast enough. So they decided, just as people in Detroit are saying that water is a human right, that energy is also a human right, that clean energy is a human right, and it is a commons. And that is the basis of the transformation in Germany. And this is, like I said, it's called remunicipalization. Reversing those privatizations has happened in hundreds of German cities, including big cities like Hamburg. I think we are in a moment where we could see a very rapid transition. And I say that because the problem with climate change is that this is a crisis that plays out in slow motion, even though I don't think humanity has ever faced an existential crisis like this. The only thing you could compare it to is the nuclear threat, but the nuclear threat was slightly different in the sense that something had to go wrong in order to bring that on. Whereas, as I said before, climate change happens if we just keep on keeping on. We don't actually have to do anything for this to be our future. So despite the fact that this is absolutely dire, it doesn't command our attention as an emergency. So it doesn't have that shock to a transformation in the same way that, for instance, the market crash of 1929 ended up being the shock that transformed the US economy and built much of the social safety net. I think climate change could be that kind of catalyst, but you have to have the right conditions for it, and those conditions haven't really been in place until now. So I think there are three factors that make this a really unique moment, that means that the stars are aligning for that kind of a justice-based transition. One is the fact that the price of oil in the past year has collapsed. And this is a true shock. It's a true shock for the market. You can ask any energy trader and they will explain that going from $150 a barrel, which is what oil was at its high, to $39 a barrel, which is what it's been at its low, is a very, very shocking change. It's just changing the energy map in ways that we don't fully understand. But it's already taking a political toll. Just in the past few months, two heads of state that bet their respective countries on fossil fuels have lost their jobs. One is Tony Abbott in Australia, who bet his country's fortune on coal and was just ousted about a month ago. And he very famously cut the ribbon at a massive new coal mine and said that coal was good for humanity. It seems that people don't agree. And in my country, in Canada, we've just booted our prime minister. So this drop in this price shock creates the conditions for some pretty bold policy. I'm not saying that just because the price of oil is down, everything's going to be fine. That's not the case at all. In fact, when the price of oil goes down, that can have all kinds of negative impacts. It encourages people to burn more oil because it's cheaper. But on the other hand, when oil is $100 a barrel, it is harder to do something we badly need to do, which is tax it. We need a carbon tax. It needs to be a progressive carbon tax so that low-income earners get more back than they pay in increased taxes, or higher-income earners bear the brunt of the tax. But we need a carbon tax. And when the price of oil is down, that creates the conditions where we could actually do it. Once again, it's not inevitable, but it creates a condition where we could fight for it and actually win in a way that was pretty much unthinkable a year from now. The other thing is that we have been living this age of extreme energies, right? Where we've been opening up new fossil fuel frontiers like the Alberta tar sands, like natural gas fracking, Arctic drilling, all of this, deep water drilling, all of this, in addition to it being higher, much higher risk from an environmental perspective, it's also really expensive. When the price of oil is as low as it is right now, that creates a disincentive to go into these new carbon frontiers. Now, we're starting to see the impacts of this. If it were just a temporary price shock, I think industry could be counted on to just wait it out. They know that what goes down will go back up eventually, and they would probably just hang steady there. But there is another factor, and this is the second major reason after the price shock why I think we are in a pretty good transition to fight for this kind of transition that I'm talking about, and that is that the climate movement, and in particular the climate justice movement, is on a roll. 6 months ago, do you guys remember those images of the Shell's Arctic drilling rig in Seattle? Made the mistake of going, you know what we'll do? We'll stop in Seattle on our way to the Arctic. What could possibly go wrong? And you know, they were surrounded by 500 kayaktivists, which is a new word. And they surrounded the rig, and in Portland, where they also made a stop, they rappelled off the bridge to try to block Shell's icebreaker. And you know, at the time, they didn't actually stop Shell from going up to the Arctic. But a few months later, Shell announced that they were pulling out of the Arctic for the foreseeable future. One, the profits are lower, it's more expensive, and these movements are there, giving them a very, very tough time. And obviously, it's not just Arctic drilling, it's every tar sands pipeline, it's every liquid natural gas terminal, it's every coal export terminal, it's oil trains, it's every new piece of fossil fuel infrastructure is facing this kind of resistance. So, in addition to that, we also have the rise of fossil fuel divestment movement. Do we have any people involved in the invest at the University of Michigan? So, you know, I was, as mentioned, I'm a board member of 350.org. 3 years ago, Bill McKibben, our founder, wrote an article for Rolling Stone called Do the Math. And, you know, as Bill likes to point out, he didn't even get the cover. Justin Bieber was on the cover. But since this article came out, which encouraged people to just do this basic piece of math, we know that our governments have said that they are committed to keeping warming below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. That puts us on a carbon budget. And climate scientists have told us how much carbon we can collectively burn if we want to give ourselves a solid chance of staying within that carbon budget, of staying below 2 degrees Celsius. And by the way, I think that's a very dangerous target, and when that target was set in Copenhagen in 2009, the African delegates walked out of their respective meetings and said that 2 degrees was a death sentence for Africa, that it was much too high. The island nations chanted 1.5 to survive, because at 2 degrees, they're still going to disappear. But 2 degrees is what our government said was dangerous. And fossil fuel companies have 5 times more carbon than that in their proven reserves, already counting towards their stock price. That's why we say we must divest. That's why Oxford has divested. That's why Stanford is divesting from coal. That's why dozens of universities are divesting. The first family of fossil fuels, as Bill said, why the heirs of the Rockefeller fortune have announced that they are divesting their foundations from fossil fuels and investing in low-carbon alternatives. So it's a little mystifying why here at the University of Michigan, your administration still won't form a committee. Right? Because it isn't just about divesting, it's also about where we move that money. And I think that that is a particularly compelling call in this part of the country, so close to Detroit, which is not just a laboratory for the shock doctrine, it is also this incredibly creative, resilient laboratory for the post-carbon economy, for urban agriculture, for green co-ops. There is so much fossil fuels. And at this point, I have to say that that incredible laboratory lost such a powerful voice recently in Grace Lee Boggs, an intellectual giant. By all those who knew and loved her and who whose lives she touched. And I think that it also compels us to carry that vision forward in her absence. You know, divestment is not an end in itself. We aren't going to bankrupt Exxon by, you know, getting our endowments out of it. This is part of a process. Every time we make the argument that these profits are illegitimate because they're based on a business model that is at war with life on Earth, we get one step closer to that carbon tax. We get one step closer to the policies that are going to help us pay for this transition. And we got a little bit closer to that this past month when revelations came out about the fact that Exxon has been researching climate science since the 1970s. And all this time, that their CEO was saying, oh, well, the science isn't clear, his own scientists were publishing in peer-reviewed journals, feeding information to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change about the reality of climate change. And this puts the fossil fuel industry, and it isn't just Exxon that was doing this research, into a very similar legal position as the tobacco companies were, and this is why, this is another level of pressure, right? We've got the price shock. We have this rising blockadia, the movement taking on fossil fuel, new fossil fuel infrastructure, wherever it is. We have the fossil fuel divestment movement, and now we have the prospect of prosecution. And we need to be signing all those petitions and calling for the prosecution of Exxon, because that's going to be the beginning of this, and getting more of those profits to pay for the transition. Okay.
Because it's not based on the campaign.
The other piece that's really exciting is that climate justice is not just a slogan. The climate justice movement is getting clearer and clearer about the policies that it will take to build the next economy that we want. As we get off fossil fuels, fighting inequality, fighting institutionalized racism, healing our societies. It's not just enough that we have a green economy. We need a fair economy. It's not just about cleaning, it's about healing the wounds that date back to our country's founding. We need a transition that delivers justice to the people whose communities have borne the brunt of the danger, the toxicity, the exploitation of the existing system. That means that we need a parade of principles. The first principle, no new fossil fuel infrastructure, no new sacrifice zones, but also, the sacrifice zones of today and yesterday need to be first in line to get the resources for energy democracy, to own and control their renewable energy projects, so that they get the jobs, the skills, and the revenues in their communities so people can stay in their home communities. This vision is being fought for in the streets. It's saying, yeah, we need climate jobs, but we need better jobs than the current system is delivering. We don't want inmates fighting fires. We want climate jobs that pay a living wage, that are unionized, that are part of the fight for 15. And we also need to redefine what a climate job is. You know, when we think about green jobs, we usually picture a guy in a hard hat putting up solar panels, and that's part of it, but that's not all that there is. We already have green sectors of our economy, low carbon sectors of our economies, that are the caregiving professionals, the people who take care of children, the elderly, our healthcare workers, our nurses. These are the existing low carbon economies that make our societies resilient, more humane in the face of disasters, and these are the very parts of our economy that are systematically under siege in the era of austerity, which is why a principle of climate justice must be that austerity is a fossilized form of thinking that is at war with life on Earth. The money we need to pay for this great transformation is out there. We just have to go after it, whether that means an end to fossil fuel subsidies, financial transaction taxes, increased royalties for fossil fuel extraction, a progressive carbon tax, and cuts to military spending. So that it can withstand increasingly frequent extreme weather events. So, you know, we know what we have to do. And, you know, as I said, sometimes I get this message that you're making our jobs harder by linking climate change to all of these other issues. And I wanted to leave you with this thought, which is that one of the biggest reason why we have failed to lower our emissions in these past 25 years that we've been talking about it is precisely because we have separated the environment from all of these other social justice struggles. It is intimately linked, and we are up against forces. But when you talk about fossil fuel companies having 5 times more carbon in their reserves than is compatible with a 2-degree temperature target, that means that if we win a safe future, they lose. They lose trillions of dollars. That's what those reserves are worth. That's why fossil fuel companies fight dirty. That's why they spread lies by funding climate change denial. That's why they buy politicians. That's why they do whatever it takes, because they're fighting for their corporate lives. When we link climate action to well-paying jobs, to badly needed infrastructure, to clean air, to clean water, to bright, not just futures, but presents, people will fight for it because it is better than what they have right now. This is not making the problem harder. This is actually the way we win. Thank you.
And I mean, I'm talking about India and the way that the community, the electorate, is moving towards the intensely and very destructively capitalist. The environment is completely sacrificed, as are the youngest peoples and so on. And I'm wondering what you might have to say that is an effective message for a community that wants to see itself, or a country that wants to see itself as kind of, you know, growing, reaching what is supposed to be a kind of first world glory and comfort, and this rising middle class and so on. You can probably get the drift of what I'm trying to get at.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So, you know, I think one of the main reasons why countries like the United States and other countries that have been burning fossil fuels at an industrial scale for more than 100 years, what are the reasons why we need to embrace justice principles in how we respond to climate change, which means that the countries that have had this enormous head start on creating the problem need to be cutting our emissions more. Not that we need to bear the entire burden. India and China also need to transition off fossil fuels, leapfrog over fossil fuels, and go directly to renewables. But when countries like the United States and Canada and Australia and the other big polluters don't cut emissions and resist all attempts to.
I mean, there's a lot of problems with the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and one of them is that we haven't been able to read the entire thing yet. But we do know that it gives the ability to multinational corporations to sue national governments, right? And so what we know from precedent is that ability to sue has been used to take on very good climate policies. For instance, I mentioned Germany. Germany is being challenged through a similar investor rights clause by a Swedish company, energy company, that was doing business in Germany. It's now suing Germany for 4.7 billion euros, saying that its transition to renewable energy is standing in the way of its plans to earn profits from coal and nuclear. That's one example. So there are other examples, like for instance, you mentioned we just heard about the fight against fracking. In Canada, the province of Quebec has successfully banned fracking. It's one of the successes, one of the early ones, but it's being challenged. It's fracking that is being challenged under NAFTA by an American gas company that says that it violates their right to drill for gas under the St. Lawrence River. So that doesn't mean they'll win, but all of this is just slowing us down when we need to be leaping ahead. It's just weighing us down. And as Joseph Stiglitz, the great economist, says, we can't sacrifice the planet because some silly lawyers wrote some rules that when they didn't understand the problem.
Hi, Ben Saylor, let me jump over here because we may have a contact with you. And I organized for the Global Investment Campaign here, so if you were a part of that, stand up. I also work for the Michigan Student Party. I want to let you know that there are campaigns all across the state that are working with us. But the one issue that we're working to is with administration. They have told us outright that divestment campaigns are irrelevant on campuses because endowments as big as ours, $9 million strong, are not political tools. So if you were able to come to, for example, a faculty senate meeting, or for example, a regents meeting, what would you say to an administrator who thinks that $9 million is not a political tool?
I would say that thank you for that. Thank you for your work. So $2.6 trillion worth of wealth has already joined the fossil fuel divestment. That, and so what I would say is get on the right side of history. You're political either way. And it is intensely political to invest that money with Exxon right now. It's intensely political to invest that money with Shell. So being apolitical in the face of this crisis is not one of the options available to us. So we just have to decide which side we want to be on.
Because even without climate change, we'd be on a collision course with planetary limits of a variety of types. Topsoil loss, aquifer depletion, biodiversity loss, the loss of our ecosystems in the oceans. So what we're talking about is a radical way of just reorganizing our own lifestyles. And I'm wondering why you don't have more of a focus on people who are reorganizing their own lifestyles. Because as Americans, we consume six times as many resources as the planet can reliably and sustainably produce. So we individually decrease our consumption of all resources by 80% or more. So what we're talking about is people living in eco-villages, using permaculture, living more like indigenous lifestyle than industrialized lifestyle. So when you talk about policies, it's kind of like a chicken and egg thing, because we're demanding these resources, and they're supplying. time. That's how the economy works. So let's stop demanding them. Let's live more simply. Let's get rid of our cars, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm wondering if you could speak to the individual component of these people who are radically transforming their own lifestyle. Perhaps talk about your own plans to transform your own lifestyle so you can walk the talk.
You know, and in the book, I do talk about that we are going to have to transform our consumption patterns, and this ideological project that I'm talking about that has been ascended since the Reagan Thatcher era has transformed our lifestyles. I mean, we consume far more than we did in the 1970s, and I'm not, you know, obviously, like, and you know, I talked about the Tyndall Center, but they when they talk about the kind of emission reductions that we need to see, they say that would bring us back to levels of consumption that would be more in line with consumption levels in the 1970s. That doesn't mean we have to consume what we consumed in the 1970s. Like, you don't have to worry about autos if you don't want to. But in terms of, you know, what happened in the 1980s, and this is what my first book was about, was just the transformation of shopping into a way of life, the rise of lifestyle branding, and the attacks on the public sphere, I think have a lot to do with why shopping has become the number one recreation activity for people who can afford it, and for people who can't afford it, because these things, when you call it chicken and egg, it is chicken and egg in the sense that you know, if you're attacking the public sphere and ways that people use to draw a sense of community, then people try to fill those gaps elsewhere, right? So I do look at it more at a policy level, although I absolutely agree that we're going to have to change the way we live, including me. But the reason why I emphasize policy as opposed to those individual actions is because I actually believe that we overemphasize those individual actions, and that part of the problem. Changing light bulbs and riding bicycles and recycling and composting and a lot of really, really good stuff that will, and eating less meat or eating no meat, and all of that will lower individual carbon footprints. But if we aren't regulating corporations, if we are allowing massive carbon frontiers to open up, we're going to get nowhere. Like,
bias towards
words claiming victory, right? So people send money, and then you say, you did it, you changed the world, right? And it's just like, and can we have more money? Because we need to change the world some more, right? So this is how a lot of organizing and fundraising works. The danger is we know that Paris is not going to be that victory, but we know that there is actually this incentive built in for groups to want to claim victory. So I think people need to, like, if you're involved in great organizations or different groups that are organizing towards Paris, send the message that we don't want false victories. We don't want to dress up a bad deal, as a good deal. And at 350, we don't talk about the road to Paris, we talk about the road through Paris to try to avoid that Copenhagen syndrome, like a summit to save the world. And then there's actually a psychologist in the UK who has diagnosed, she's coined this new syndrome called Copenhagen syndrome, and then people were so depressed after Copenhagen because they thought this was going to fix everything, and then it didn't, and then they didn't know what to do. So it doesn't mean that it doesn't matter, it does matter, but we already know enough to know that it's going to be inadequate, and we're going to keep doing what we're doing and keep building this movement that is growing, and the more it builds, the more policy victories we can see. I'm wondering if you could inform people about what Canada knows about this issue for those who I think might not know.
Well, it's wonderful that so many groups who are actually doing the work are here, and please, educate yourself, go to the tables, find out more. It's a local issue, a water safety issue, and it is a local issue. Has very high methane emissions, greenhouse gas. So this is an example of how protecting your home place is also protecting our collective home. And unfortunately, I'm getting the signal that we are wrapping up. So we're going to wrap, guys. I'm sorry, I'm just going to leave you with a quote, okay? Because I know that this can feel really overwhelming. First, I just want to thank, this group clearly has some incredible activists. If you are fighting for water rights, who are fighting for fossil fuel divestment and investment, who are fighting for a fair and nourishing local agriculture system, who are fighting against fracking, and I'm sure lots of things that we haven't heard from. So, I always feel like I'm just an excuse to get people in a room together, just talk to each other, and the answers are out there. And one of the people who really has inspired me in my work is Wendell Berry, the great farmer, poet, activist. And he says, we don't have a right to ask whether we're going to succeed or not. The question we have a right to ask is, what is the right thing to do? What does this earth require of us if we want to continue to live on it? The stakes are so high that if we have any, this is me now, not Wendell. The stakes are so high that if we have any chance avoiding catastrophe, we all have the moral responsibility to do everything we can to expand the chances of success. We don't fight because we know we're going to win. We fight because it's right and it's just.